One of the core items of the Gravity Falls series was the coveted Journal 3. Dipper Pines used this special book to uncover the mysteries of Gravity Falls, and then years later, we are still discovering some of the biggest secrets. Have you read the book? Seen the show? Curious about all the secrets? Well, come on a journey with us as we dive deep into Journal 3 and reveal a lot of the hidden secrets, moments, and revelations from the show.
Remember, in Gravity Falls, there is no one you can trust.
Through both seasons of Gravity Falls, we got to know so much about Dipper Pines, except his first name. Fans speculated for years what his real name could be, and it turns out Journal 3 would be the source of the definitive answer. Flipping through the publication of the real journal, and you'll spot a letter from Ford written specifically about Dipper. And then, out of nowhere, a quote from Dipper reveals his real name, Mason. And the name fits perfectly. Mason and Mabel go together so well and provide a clearer picture of the character. The show could have easily saved this revelation for the series finale, but holding off until the publication of Journal 3 gave fans another secret to uncover, and it was a fun way to expand the mythology of the show, even though no new episodes were getting produced. Mabel obviously knew his real name, and now Ford knows it as well, but who else in Gravity Falls knows his name? Wendy figured out the origins of his nickname due to his constellation birthmark, but never knew about the real name. Other than that, everyone else in town just refers to him as Dipper, and even knowing his real name is Mason, we'll still keep calling him Dipper as well. The cover of Journal 3 is as iconic as the contents inside it. A six-figured hand is paired with the number 3 on the front, and this is the cover that we got in the actual printed version of the journal as well. But it always wasn't intended this way. While the plot was being conceived for Gravity Falls, the whole mythology behind Journal 3 wasn't fully planned out yet, and Journal 3 wasn't even going to be just one of three journals. Instead, the book Dipper discovers through his Gravity Falls adventures was actually called Dr. Crackpot's Book of the Damned. The book itself featured bones on the cover and on the spine, along with a pentagram on the back. Clearly, a title and design like this wouldn't fly by Disney censors. Gravity Falls creator Alex Hirsch even revealed storyboards where the book was supposed to be titled Dr. Crackpot's Index of the Damned, and a glimpse of the non-canon character Dr. Crackpot could be seen. Very fitting to his name, he wore a crackpot on his head. As production dove deeper into the mythology and mystery of the show, the journal was renamed, and the rest was history. The best part of seeing Journal 3 on episodes of Gravity Falls was being able to pause the show and really take in all the details displayed on the pages. And well, for anyone pausing scenes in the episode Tourist Trapped, you would get a pretty surprising glimpse at something in the journal which should have never been there. As Dipper confides in Mabel about the journal and then showcases the page with the zombie, look closely to spot the page before it. Instead of featuring Ford's signature cursive in handwriting, it's actually an entry from Dipper. The only problem, Dipper has not written this entry yet, and he doesn't do so until the end of the episode. So, how did that page get mixed up with the rest? The easiest explanation is an animation error, but this is Gravity Falls after all, so maybe there's some mystery behind it. The journal could have a life of its own, be involved in some time travel elements, or have magical properties where future entries could be viewed as specific times. Either way, you can get a glimpse at Dipper's entry before the thing is even seen on the pages for the first time. We wonder how many of you noticed this on the very first viewing of Gravity Falls. One of the biggest mysteries building up throughout the entire first season was figuring out who the author of Journal 3 was. There were a lot of clues given, and the show finally revealed some secrets in Season 2 when Stan's twin brother Ford Pines was revealed to be the author of all three mysterious journals. While many people predicted the great twist, the show went out of its way to give other clues to who the author was. One of them even involved sending out official promotional shots for an episode that ended up being a big hoax. In the picture, a younger version of Old Man McGucket could be seen writing in some type of journal. A small monocle made it seem like the book was Journal 3, and as McGucket wrote, you could see six fingers on his hand. While rumors spread like wildfire, the whole picture was a big hoax and just another great planning element from the Gravity Falls production staff. Keeping the secret of the journal was essential to the core of the show, and pulling stunts like this really helped create a lot of fan theories and allowed the show to throw people off track. It turned out that McGucket was involved with the journal though, as he served as an assistant to Four Pines during their experiments back in the day. The best part of reading through Journal 3 and seeing the entries is how authentic it all seems. Things are crossed out, written over, and edited as if Ford went back to update various entries. This couldn't be more true in Ford's entry for Bill Cipher. Bill Cipher and Ford Pines have a long history together, filled with a lot of drama, but things didn't always start out this way. Early on, one of Ford's first descriptions of Bill describes him as being the friendliest guy. So obviously, when Ford first met Bill, things weren't all evil at first. Bill played his cards right, using his personality to woo Ford over. And this shows through the journal. Ford seems to slowly catch on as the entry gets updated with more information, and he eventually crossed out everything he wrote to write Bill can't be trusted in big, bold red letters. Now we know why Bill always wore a bow tie. The master manipulator charmed his way into people's minds using his looks, knowledge, and ability to manipulate others. Of course, several other entries focus on the danger Bill represents, and Dipper found out the hard way when Bill took over his body to create the character known as Bipper. One of the best parts of reading Journal 3 and discovering it through the show is seeing all of the various monsters hidden throughout the pages. There's a whole section devoted to ghosts and all their various forms as well. The ghosts in the book is split up into 9 different categories, each one covering their design, powers, and the way they haunt others. The first category simply labels the ghosts as A. The reason? These ghosts are not a problem and considered friendly ghosts. For older fans of Gravity Falls, the ghost depicted in the illustration may look familiar. This is because the design and description is based off of Casper, the friendly ghost. The round head and body design is definitely similar to Casper, and the description makes this even clearer. Ford writes how encountering the ghost and talking to it will make it your best friend. This is exactly what Casper does when coming face to face with a number of his human counterparts, especially young children. The homage to the classic cartoon ghost is a great showcase of previous animations that helped pave the way for Gravity Falls and provide them with a lot of influence for stories and character designs. The Category 1 ghost isn't the only ghost holding secrets inside of Journal 3. Just a few entries later, and you'll spot the Category 3 ghosts known as gluttons. In the illustration, we see the glutton chowing down on a number of cheeseburgers. The inspiration for this entry is clearly taken from Ghostbusters and their signature ghost, Slimer. In multiple movies and cartoons, Slimer is a clear glutton, including the 2016 film where he raids a hot dog cart and eats as much as he can. For further proof, the description of the ghost refers to the character looking very similar to Gore from Phantom Bustafires. It doesn't take a detective to figure out the clear connection and homage to Slimer from Ghostbusters. Later on, categories 7 and 8 may also refer to the two villains from the original Ghostbusters as the Keymaster and Gatekeeper. The drawings don't portray Rick Moranis and Sigourney Weaver, but are pretty much literal representations of what their characters were supposed to be. We have the ghost with the key for a head, and the gatekeeper rock, which was a keyhole so the two can connect and become an unstoppable force. While each journal stands on its own, Ford knew what he was doing ahead of time while creating each journal. When all three journals were placed together, more clues could be uncovered, including ways to activate the portal. Getting this message to appear isn't easy, though. All of the journals must be opened to the correct page and placed under a black light to reveal the hidden message. The message itself essentially says that the universe portal machine is far too powerful and the use of it could destroy the whole Earth. While a warning like this is certainly important, you would think that Ford would make this warning a little more clear. You know, maybe on the cover of the whole book. Keeping the message hidden underneath blacklight ink makes it nearly impossible to discover and encourages to use the machines otherwise. Either way, it's still cool to see how all three journals connect, and we would love to get our hands on printed editions of the first two journals to dive deeper into the mythology of the show. If you got your copy of Journal 3 and are flipping through page after page to look for the section of Percepts Rooms, you can stop looking now. Yes, the show showcased this page in the episode Little Gift Shop of Horrors, but you'll never see the page printed in the journal. The reason? The episode was fabricated, a tall tale told by Stan Pines and not considered canon to the show. There's even a cryptogram at the end of the episode which translates to non-canon. The perceptrooms were a mushroom that could be picked, ground to jelly, and rubbed on a person's head to make them more intelligent. While it worked for Waddles the pig, everything in the episode was just a fabrication, including the secret page within the journal. Keeping the page out of the actual published journal showcases how detailed the show gets when it comes to authenticity. They could have easily included the page for fun, but perceptrooms are not a real thing in the world of Gravity Falls, and the page can only be seen in the Little Gift Shop of Horrors episode of the show. While the perceptrooms page was not included in the journal, there was another key entry which was left out as well. It turns out this entry was supposed to be used for far more than just the journal. It was supposed to be a whole episode of the show. While doing a live panel discussing the show and Journal 3, a couple of journal pages were revealed showcasing a character known as the Doll Collector. Not only did the Doll Collector enjoy collecting dolls, but she turned small children into dolls as well. She was an old lady who Mabel and Dipper encountered when going door to door while trying to sell Grunkle Stan bobbleheads. An illustration showcases Gideon in his doll form and some sort of sock monkey who ends up becoming one of the heroes of the story. This plot was the basis for the whole episode of the show, which was eventually cut and excluded from the journal as well. It seems like movies like Toy Story 4 have tapped into the whole creepy doll thing pretty well at this point. Maybe one day we'll get to see the Doll Collector story in the form of a comic or graphic novel, and they could even release a special edition of the journal with lost entries and pages. Okay, we have to go back to the ghost pages. There are just too many references and secrets we cannot skip over. Clearly, Alex Hirsch and his creative team draw a lot of influence from horror movies, and one of the more obvious references can be found with the Dream Hipster. The character was clearly inspired from the Nightmare on Elm Street's Freddy Krueger. Not really a secret there, but if you go back a few pages, the Category 6 ghost is referred to as Phantoms of Pain. With nails in their whole body, a bald head, and leather outfits, the reference is directly tied to a classic horror franchise which many younger fans may not be aware of. The Phantoms of Pain are clearly based off Pinhead from the Hellraiser series. Not as well known as Freddy Krueger, Pinhead is the leader of the Cenobites, a group of characters who live in another dimension. While the Phantoms of Pain look like they're smiling, it's far different in the Hellraiser movies. They are creatures who cannot differentiate pleasure from pain and showcase it when haunting their victims. Yeah, so definitely something the younger kiddos should not be finding connections to when researching the Journal 3 content. After multiple episodes dealing with monsters, ghosts, and garden gnomes, the show gave us a whole different type of beast in The Land Before Swine. The episode featured Mabel, Dipper, Stan, and Seuss going on a prehistoric adventure to an underground land where dinosaurs still roam. After escaping the deadly threat of the dinosaurs, we don't hear much about the Dino Land until you go flipping through the journal. Thanks to some new entries, we learn that Stan actually stole a dinosaur egg from the underground lair. Over the course of several days, the egg hatches, a compy dinosaur is born, and Stan quickly realizes he has his hands full. The compy follows him around like he's the mother and quickly learns the way of life through the actions of Stan. The dinosaur steals money from tourists, becomes obsessed with cash, and Stan decides to contact a farmer who has the ability to handle some unusual characters. All of these entries have made for some great bonus content at the end of the episode. For viewers who just saw the show, it seemed like the only souvenir everyone got was the dinosaur tooth that was stuck inside Dipper's vest from their attack scenes. While living in Gravity Falls, Ford Pines has been through a lot. He's seen all types of monsters, crazy events, and years of mysteries before Dipper and Mabel arrived for their summer adventure. This is why you'll find some really strange things inside of Journal 3 reflecting these experiences. One thing that could have easily passed by readers of the journal was the entry of vampire bats. The early entry in the journal discusses the bats and how they crave human blood instead of just animal blood, and Ford seems a little too understanding of these vampire bats' eating habits. In a crossed-out section of the journal, Ford talks about how human blood tastes better than other types of blood. Ford, how would you know this? After stating this fact, Ford tries to cover things up by using the word assume, and adding an extra note to clarify that he has not tasted human blood. Well, with the overindulgence of cover-ups, we're finding this one a little hard to believe. So yeah, let's go ahead and make this canon. Ford has tasted human blood, and he completely understands why a giant vampire bat would want to do the same. Yikes. Zombies have been a huge part of Gravity Falls. Initially, we thought zombies were in the first episode of the show, but that turned out to be a bunch of gnomes stacking up on each other. Season 2 presented the true forms of zombies as they terrorized everyone in Gravity Falls. The episode Scaryoki showcased the use of song to defeat them, and the way that Dipper discovered this was through another secret entry in the Journal 3. Using a blacklight, Dipper found a secret ink that showcased the only way to defeat the zombies was through a perfect three-part harmony. Once again, we have to question Ford's intentions. If he knew how to defeat the zombies, why would he make it a secret section in his journal? Obviously, the content wasn't there before, and the blacklight definitely helps with retcons. Too bad the published version doesn't feature all of the great blacklight content. It would double the time we spent reading the various pages in the book. Either way, the season 2 episode showcased there were plenty of secrets left to discover in Journal 3. We just have to wonder how many other hidden monsters are still in the journal. When Dipper left Gravity Falls, he left Journal 3 behind as well. Ford got his precious journal back and has even updated it with some new entries. As for Dipper, his journal days weren't done. After spending a whole summer writing about monsters, ghosts, and mysteries, he would continue this writing back at home. As revealed near the end of the journal, Dipper has his very own journal for topics on life back in California. Instead of a handprint or number on the front, Dipper went with the next best thing, a pine tree. The signature tree is the same one found on his hat and is a great representation of his last name. If only we could get a peek into the new journal, we might have more clues and information on some of the contents. Then again, it could set up a whole new show in the future, or possibly some type of graphic novel in the least. Also revealed in the journal is Dipper's decision to give Ford back his journal. With this decision, Dipper no longer has access to any of the entries. Unless the journal was also published nationally in the show universe and got to appear on the New York Times bestseller list like it did in our world. Wow, that's a whole lot of secrets. What one was the most fascinating? Were there any that we missed? Do you own a copy of Journal 3? Should Disney release more journals in the future? Let us know in the comments below, and then don't forget to subscribe to Screen Rant for more great content.